And with that, now we are going to move on into our next segment. And for that, I'm going to be introducing our state director, Dana Marie Kennedy. She will be interviewing the Honorable Secretary of State, Katie Hobbs. Dana, floor is yours.
Good morning. Thank you, Alex. And hello to all of our advocates on the line here on our very first virtual day at the Capitol. So it is my honor to introduce our next guest, Secretary of State, Katie Hobbs. Katie was first elected to office in 2010 to the House of Representatives. She then moved over to the state Senate, and she enjoyed a great career there. And she was then elected by her peers to be the minority leader of the Senate. And she ran and successfully won to become our Secretary of State in 2018. So it's an honor to introduce our next speaker, Secretary of State Katie Hobbs. Good morning, Katie.
Hi, good morning. So happy to be here with all of you.
How are you?
I'm good.
Great.
I miss real days at the Capitol, but glad you're doing the virtual day. So
yeah, we wish we were at the Capitol as well, but this is what we have to do in this day and age. So I want to ask you a question. It seems like this was one of the best run elections since I've been in Arizona. What is your take, and why are there so many bills focusing on electoral reform?
Well, thank you, first of all, for that recognition. I want to agree with you that it was one of the best run elections we've had in a long time here. Not just one, we had three elections in 2020, and they were all very successful, saw historic turnout across the state. So I am so proud of the work that my team was able to do. We were incredibly focused, first of all, on just building partnership with the local election officials and the community organizations that work to engage voters to ensure that we had smooth elections. And then that became really critical in the pandemic as we focused really on ensuring that no Arizona voter had to choose between that freedom to vote and their health and safety. And I think, you know, the widespread historic turnout really demonstrates the effectiveness that we were able to have there. In the face of a pandemic and in the face of widespread misinformation being directed at voters. So I'm, again, just really proud of the work we did. And, you know, it's unfortunate that that on the heels of the successful election that we should be celebrating the historic turnout and what we are able to accomplish, that we are seeing so much sort of disguised as election reform legislation, but really legislation that's based on the misinformation about the election, the misinformation that was put out there to undermine voters' confidence in the system, and legislation really that doesn't go about reforming the elections, but really seeks to limit participation. My office put forward a package that would streamline election administration, increase voter access, and enhance election security. And unfortunately, that bill that was informed by our experience through this last election has not gotten a hearing. And none of the bills that are moving forward now that we're concerned about are designed to do those things or designed with input from election officials at all. So it's pretty concerning and disheartening, especially on the heels of this successful elections in 2020.
Yeah, because I remember in 2018, I mean, there were lines. I went to drop off my ballot, and I know, you know, the sun went down. People were waiting in lines. People were making sure people had water, and they're delivering pizza to make sure people were able to vote. So it was great to see such a well-run election this time around. It seems to me that there are a number of bills that may be of concern to especially our older voters. Could you share what some of those bills are and if there's anything that we should be doing to advocate for those bills to either get passed or that they don't get passed?
Sure. The first bill, and this unfortunately has already been passed and signed by Governor Ducey into law, but it seeks to prohibit, it doesn't seek to, it will prohibit private funding in election administration. And the reason this is important is because As we headed into the pandemic, we knew that we needed a lot of additional resources for the election, not just here in Arizona, but across the country. And Congress passed the CARES Act, which election officials across the country really viewed as a down payment in terms of the election funding that was part of the CARES Act. And Arizona was awarded $9 million from the CARES Act for specific expenses related to the pandemic with the election. And then unfortunately, our state legislature blocked our office repeatedly from getting those dollars, and then other dollars that were designed for public education. And I know that our public education campaign that we were able to engage in made sure that voters had the information they needed to vote safely in this election. It was a really critical piece of our efforts. And so, but we were able to fund that because there was private grants that supplemented the blocked dollars that our state legislature blocked us from getting. And, you know, we worked with Governor Ducey's office to help secure that grant. And even though he has agreed that there was nothing nefarious about those private dollars and that they weren't used to influence the election, he went ahead and signed this bill that will prohibit that kind of partnership, public-private partnership in the future. So that's very concerning. And, you know, I think, we were very focused on public education to make sure voters had the tools they needed. And so that ability in the future is definitely going to be limited unless our legislature steps up and provides the funding that we actually need to administer elections. The other two bills that are still moving and I believe are over in the House ready for action from the floor. And so it would be important to contact your House members about these two bills. The first one is 1485, and this would allow or require county recorders to purge voters early voter list if they choose not to use their early ballot in four elections. So I want to just give a quick reminder about our early voting in Arizona. We have had no excuse absentee voting for decades here. And then for at least a decade or close to a decade, more than a decade, the permanent early voter list. So voters, instead of having to write a ballot by mail every election, can just get on that permanent early voter list, and then every single election that they're eligible to vote in, they will receive the ballot in the mail. And these two laws were passed by Republican majority legislatures. And now it's the really, on a partisan basis, the Republicans that are attacking our very successful vote by mail program here in Arizona, and that's one of the ways. And so I think for especially folks that are homebound or have issues with ballot access, being on the permanent early voter list is, you know, the thing that makes sure that they can vote every single election. And what we saw in 2020 was a lot of people were very anxious to get out and vote. They wanted to make sure that something didn't happen that prevented that. And so they didn't even want to wait for their early ballot in the mail. They showed up at the polling place on the first day of early voting, and our system allows that. If you go to vote in person, it cancels your early ballot. You don't have to use the early ballot. It still makes sure that your vote counts. And this would, if somebody did that, this would be one check mark against them being removed from the permanent early voter list. And that's not the way our system was designed. So that's a very concerning bill. That again is 1485. And the other bill is 1713. And this bill puts a lot of additional requirements on your mail-in ballot. So just as a reminder, nobody can get a mail-in ballot unless you're a registered voter. And to register to vote in Arizona, you have to prove your citizenship. So there's a lot of layers of security around making sure that voters are eligible, even voters that get their early ballot. And so, if you vote in person, you have to show ID. If you vote by mail, the way that your identity is verified is through your signature on the affidavit on that early ballot. And so this bill 1713 puts additional requirements on that affidavit. And I think the biggest concern for me is that the more steps you require in the process, the more likelihood there is for errors. And then that makes more ballots eligible for disqualification or to be thrown out and votes that won't be counted. And so the additional requirement for the affidavit is adding you have to put some ID number, either your voter registration number or your driver's license number. So I still have my voter registration card. I carry it in my wallet, but I'm probably weird and a lot of people don't do that. So you could look that number up online, but again, extra barrier to just getting that done. Or you can use a driver's license or non-operating ID, but not everybody has that ID. Again, people that are homebound might not have that piece of identification. So again, just another barrier. Even though there are additional identifications that are acceptable for voter ID, the affidavit ID is limited to those two pieces. So if you have a tribal ID card, a passport, a military ID that allows you to vote, you can't use that on this affidavit. Again, making it more likely that ballots are gonna be tossed because they don't meet all the requirements. And this is fixing a problem that doesn't exist. Our vote by mail system is very secure and it's been a model for other states in the country. So there's no reason to tamper with it this way.
Thank you so much. And we are getting a couple of questions that are coming in. So hopefully we can get to those real quickly. And you kind of answered this already, but what changes are being addressed to change election laws and prevent votes from being counted from people who are not legally registered to vote? He put dead illegally in the U.S. registered with a P.O. box or in other illegal ways, or have not have their signatures verified, and to stop sending bulk mail in ballots to people who have not requested them.
Well,
it's kind of a lot in one question.
So the county, the job of the county recorder, their main job as the registrar of voters is to make sure that our voter lists are accurate and up to date, and that folks who are registering to vote are eligible to register to vote. And we have a lot of statutes and procedures in place around how this happens. There's also federal law in place about, how to maintain voter rolls. And so our county recorders are doing their job in this regard. And anyone who registers to vote has to go, there's a citizen check on that voter registration. And again, part of that list maintenance is the maintenance of the permanent early voter list and making sure that voters who are requesting ballots by mail are eligible to vote, and that those ballots are not being sent to ineligible voters. So I have to say that our county recorders are doing their job in this regard, and that is really one of their main functions. And so a lot of information out there about people getting ballots who shouldn't be getting ballots is just misinformation, and people who are not informed about the process and how it works and the way things happen in this election. There was a lot of that going on. And I just have to say that is just not true. If you move and you do not forward or you do not change your voter registration address, that mail doesn't get sent. Election mail is not forwardable. It will get returned to the county recorder, and then they have to update their records accordingly. So again, just a lot of this out there is just really misinformation.
Thank you. And then we have one more question from Frank. He says that, I guess, wanting comments about the $150,000 the Senate is spending to conduct an audit of the 2020 election.
I guess the $150,000 that's in the scope of work, it seems woefully inadequate to me to conduct the kind of audit that they're talking about conducting. But I mean, part of that goes to the fact that this firm that was selected by the Senate doesn't actually have any auditing experience or any election experience. And so that's kind of evident in the scope of work that they outlined, and then the questions they're asking about how to go about conducting that scope of work, because they don't understand our election process. And $150,000 is in no way an adequate amount to conduct this kind of audit. So that money, I assume, will be coming from taxpayers. The Senate has a budget that they can spend without approval. So that's where I would assume it's coming from. But if I was a taxpayer, which I am, I would be concerned about this.
Great. And before we end, could you give any advice to our members as far as, since you were in the House and the Senate, the best way for them to advocate with their elected officials?
Well, I always tell people it starts with trying to meet them and have some kind of personal relationship, whether that's just, you know, on the, when they're on the campaign trail, showing up at campaign events. So then when you are advocating for a specific issue, there's some context there and your legislators know who you are and their station. Now, I know that doesn't necessarily always work for everybody, but I think that participating in this kind of lobby day is very effective at getting to meet your legislators that way. And I would say I have a stack of personal letters that have come to my office throughout my time, and I kept them in the legislature as well. Those personal handwritten or even just typed, they stand out because emails, you can send 100 emails in a very short amount of time, but taking the time to write a letter is something that stands out and kind of is a little more noticeable. So if you're going to do one thing, I would suggest that. But taking the time to meet your legislators, even when you're not necessarily advocating for a specific issue, so that you have that personal connection with them.
Great. Well, thank you so much. Well, we are out of time. So I want to thank you so much for spending your part of your day morning with us. And I'm going to now hand it back over to Alex.